بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سل بني إسرائيل كم آتيناهم من آية بينة ومن يبدل نعمة الله من بعد ما جاءته فإن الله شديد العقاب. زين للذين كفروا الحياة الدنيا ويسخرون من الذين آمنوا والذين اتقوا فوقهم يوم القيامة والله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب. كان الناس أمة واحدة فبعث الله النبيين مبشرين ومنذرين وأنزل معهم الكتاب بالحق ليحكم بين الناس فيما اختلفوا فيه وما اختلف فيه إلا الذين أوتوه من بعد ما جاءتهم البينات بغيا بينهم فهدى الله الذين آمنوا لما اختلفوا فيه من الحق بإذنه والله يهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. أم حسبتم أن تدخلوا الجنة ولما يأتكم مثل الذين خلوا من قبلكم مستهم البأساء والضراء وزلزلوا حتى يقول الرسول والذين آمنوا معه متى نصر الله ألا إن نصر الله قريب. يسألونك ماذا ينفقون قل ما أنفقتم من خير فللوالدين والأقربين واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل وما تفعلوا من خير فإن الله به عليم. صدق الله العظيم. We are starting from ayah number 211 today of Surah Al-Baqarah. سَلْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ كَمْ آتَيْنَاهُمْ مِنْ آيَةٍ بَيِّنَةٍ. Ask the children of Israel, how many clear signs we have given to them. وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. And whoever changes the blessings of Allah after they have come to him, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ, then Allah surely is most severe in punishment. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sal Bani Israel, asked Bani Israel how many clear signs we have given them. Sometime the question is asked and for investigating, for learning, for knowing. And that is called Su'al al-Tahqiq in Arabic language. Su'al al-Tahqiq means, I would like to know, I want to find out. But at other times, the question is asked for reprimanding someone, for reminding someone of his wrongdoings. Two brothers are fighting, and father is being the mediator between the two of them. And one of the brothers said to his father, he says, but ask him, why did he push me? Now this ask him does not mean he really is looking for justification why his brother pushed him. He wants to remind him that you did this to me. Sal bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or anyone to ask bani Israel because we want to know what was the reason behind it. This is to remind them that you people got so many clear signs and yet you refused to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ayahs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You rejected the ayahs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Sal bani Israel, kam ataynahum min ayatin bayyina. Ask these children of Israel, ask bani Israel, how many clear signs we have given to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them so many clear signs, as Quran also speaks about many of those, like Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wa salam's stick. That one stick had many signs in that just one stick. Also, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wa salam's hand, as it would become out, it would come out shiny. It was a clear sign of his nabuwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is splitting the ocean for them. When they were in the desert, having a cloud to provide a shadow for them. All of these things and hundreds of those signs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْ. The problem is that when someone gets too many blessings, does not appreciate it. I gave them too many blessings. I made things very easy for them. And they did not appreciate it. And this is a fact with human beings, that after receiving a lot of blessings, then we don't appreciate these blessings. We tend to forget the blessings that we receive. A person who is in difficulty, when he receives a glass of water, he really thanks Allah for that glass of water. And a person who never had any difficulty getting a water in his life would never appreciate a glass of water. In fact, if there is something wrong with that glass of water, there is some dirt in it, or someone delayed giving him the water, he will start complaining. Not appreciating how much water I'm getting on daily basis. Every day I'm getting so much, but I don't appreciate that. One day I miss something and I start complaining. وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. Whoever will change Allah's blessings after receiving them. What does changing the blessing means? Changing the blessing simply means that a person makes the blessing to become a source of disobedience. It was a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now this blessing is being used to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us money. And the purpose of giving us that ni'mah was, we take care of our needs. We fulfill our own needs, our family's needs, the needs of people around us. We help people with it. But instead of taking care of our family or our neighbors or our needy people, we started putting all of that money in our desires, just to fulfill our desires, and many times using the same money that came as a ni'mah, as a blessing of Allah, using it for disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. Whoever will change Allah's ni'mah, Allah's blessing, after receiving it, he should remember Allah's punishment is very severe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will keep on giving it to you. You will have it for some time. And that some time could mean the person may lose these blessings in this dunya, as it happens to many people. And in other occasions, a person does not lose these ni'mas in this life. But a day would come when we will have to leave all of this behind us. And we will be placed in our qabr. We will not take our account, our balance, our money, our job, our degrees, our education, our car, our home, our relatives. We will not take any of these people or any of these things with us. And at that time, then we will have to pay for misusing the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Whoever will change Allah's blessings after receiving them, Allah's punishment is very severe. Why people do not appreciate the ni'mah that they receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What's the main reason behind it? We know there are so many people around us that are having a difficulty just surviving. There are people who don't have a car. And whenever they need to get anywhere, they have to ask people for a ride. They have to go to the bus stand, wait for the bus to come. They want to go a long distance. They have to wait for the train. They don't have their own car. Others can't afford to pay the rent for their home. So they have to look for people to help them so that they can pay the rent. There are people who don't have so many other things that we have. If we put ourselves in their situation and we think what they are facing, what difficulty they are having because of not having what we have, we may think it will be difficult for me to live in that way. I can't really live like that. It's impossible for me to live like this. And we all have such ni'mas that others are missing. There isn't any person in the world who can say that I don't have any ni'mah. Take a simple example. A person like us, we may think that if I can't pray, I can't live. But there are so many people who can't pray. They don't pray, either by choice or by force. Everyone has some ni'mas that others don't have. The point is, do we appreciate those ni'mas of Allah that we have, or we keep on looking at things that we don't have? وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. Whoever will change the ni'mah of Allah after receiving it, Allah's punishment is very severe. He will take even what we have. Or at least we will not be able to benefit from what we have. Now the question is, when people have, especially they have worldly ni'mah, people who have money, they have got a good education, all of that, what's the reason behind them not appreciating this ni'mah? Why do they forget that I'm supposed to appreciate it? Maybe the same person, if you look at his history, 20 years back, he was against those rich people who have all of this money. He used to say, you know, these rich people are like this, they're like this, they're like this. Now when he is in the same situation, he's behaving the same way. What makes him behave that way? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautifully answers that in the next ayah. زُيِّنَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. The worldly life has been beautified for the disbelievers. وَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Let's stop at this point. And then we'll see what's the next portion of the ayah is telling us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in simple words is telling us that the reason for not appreciating Allah's ni'mah is the person gets lost in the beauty of the dunya. This dunya has been beautified. Who beautified this dunya for us? The creator of it. Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala made it look nice. And of course, everyone likes things in this life. If you go to a nice garden and we see beautiful flowers, beautiful birds, animals, we like those. And you like to see these things around you. You see a beautiful bird, you wish if the bird will come and sit on your hand. You see a very nice, colorful bird. You see a nice animal, rabbit, something like this is running around you. This is all part of the beauty. Sometimes this beauty becomes so attractive that the person forgets about his own self running after the beauty of it. We forget about ourselves. We forget about what I was here for. You went to talk to someone and then you started looking at the game. That person was watching a game and you started looking at that game and you forgot the message that you were supposed to deliver to the person. This is the beauty of this dunya. How many times this happens to us, and especially these days, you see it very common. A person pulls out his phone and he was supposed to call, make an important call, and you see a text message. And then you start texting those people. And then they text you back. And you keep on texting back and forth, back and forth. Half an hour is gone. You forgot what you got to phone out for. This is what this dunya is all about. This is the reality of the dunya. These are small examples. For some people, they forget their work for half an hour, for an hour. For some time, for some people, they forget their lives, themselves, for a couple of days. For some people, they forget themselves for a couple of years. There are people who forget their children, their families, everything. They don't care about what's happening to them. They're too busy with it. And for some people, they spend their whole life in the same way, that they don't realize what they were here for. The whole life is gone. The person never realized what he was here for. He just grew up playing those games and continued playing these games until he died. That's it. That was his whole life. زَيِّنَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that's the way of the kuffar. Sometime, Muslims also fall into the same steps. That's not the life of a Muslim. Muslim is not supposed to run after the beauty of it. He's not supposed to forget his Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala, his position and his responsibility because of the beauty of the dunya. زَيِّنَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. This is the reason for forgetting the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for not appreciating the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's the reason? The reason is running after the beauty of the dunya. And when the person keeps on running after the beauty, that never comes to an end. How many things we buy and you think that this is the best thing I'm going to get? If I got this, then I have everything. This is what I want. And it took us some months to buy it, to get it, to convince our elders to buy it, or to collect the money to buy it. After we got it, you saw someone who has something better than that one. And now it's constantly on your mind. I have iPhone 4 right now, but I want the 5. And I'm waiting for it to come out. And now you just keep on looking forward to it. And someone who has something different. Oh, I think I need to go for that one now. This beauty never comes to an end. Allah has beautified it. And the beauty will continue. If we run after the beauty, we will be just spending everything on these beauties. And we will be destroying our time, our life, our energy after the beauty of the world, and will never be able to fulfill our responsibilities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, زُيِّنَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. For the disbelievers, the worldly life have been made too beautiful, have been beautified for them. Of course, it's been beautified for everyone. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا. Whatever is on the earth, we made it a beauty of this world. لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. The reason for making that beauty, for creating this beauty, is to test people and see who would do good deeds. A person with true iman will see the beauty of iman and will go to iman, will fulfill the requirement of his iman. A person with true faith, he would see the beauty of his salah, he will see the beauty of Quran, he will see the beauty of ibadah, he will go after that. A person who cannot see, does not have the eye, does not have the ruh, does not have the heart through which he can see the beauty of deen, the beauty of Quran, the beauty of salah, that person will always be running after the beauty of this dunya. زُيِّنَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. The worldly life has been beautified for the disbelievers. They are the ones who are running after the beauty of this dunya. A mu'min is not supposed to be doing that. ويسخرون من الذين آمنوا ويسخرون من الذين آمنوا. The natural consequences of running after the beauty and becoming wealthy once you acquired the beauty. Subhanallah, look how step by step Allah is taking us to understanding the reality of this world. وَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. A person who has the beauty of this dunya, what happens? He starts making fun of those who do not have these things. وَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And they laugh at those who believe. They make fun of those who believe. They mock those who believe. Because kuffar and are the ones who are supposed to be running after the zinatul dunya, the beauty of the dunya. And now what they do is, they make fun of those people who don't want to go after this beauty, who don't have these things. And this is of course very common that we see it, that wealthy people, when they are sitting together, there is another person there who is not in their category, in their level, who's not as wealthy as they are, who does not live in the same neighborhood where they live. He does not live in a high class neighborhood, does not have the same type of degrees in the work, does not have the same amount of money, does not drive the same type of car. They will start looking down at that person. Oh, look at him. You know, he has nothing. They will always look down at that person. It's very common, very natural. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. They make fun of those who believe. But وَالَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Those, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا, the people of taqwa, the people of piety, will be above them on the day of Qiyamah. Will be above them in both situations, physically and spiritually. Physically, because Jannah will be higher places, and Jahannam will be the lower place, asfalus safilin. And spiritually, they will be above them. They would see that these people were really above us. Their status was higher than us, but we never realized it. It's really a big problem when a person has the habit of making fun of others. We don't realize it, what type of problem we have. We think that, oh, this person really has a good sense of humor when he makes fun of others. Yes, people have sense of humor and they can make good jokes or whatever. We are not talking against that. But when a person has the habit of making fun of others, this is one of the major problems that this person has. In fact, it's considered to be one of the very grievous sins in Islam, because the reason you would make fun of others is only when you consider yourself better than others. You would never make fun of someone who you would consider to be better than you. If the person is better than me, why would I make fun of him? If I see some dirt on someone's face and I start making fun of it, I would do that only because I think my face is clean. But if I know that there is more dirt on my face than his face, I would try to even hide his dirt because I don't want people to see my dirt. Because if people will make fun of that, then they will make even more fun of me, because I have more dirt on my face. So it's better that if someone is making fun of him, you say, no, stay quiet. Be quiet. Don't say anything about him. Because you know it will come to you next. But when I'm making fun of the other person, it's only because I think, no, I'm better than him. That's the only time when we'll make fun of others. This is why sukhriya, making fun of others, is a sign of arrogance. Is a sign that we think that we are something. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like, when a person considers himself to be greater than others, better than others, and therefore makes fun of others. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith narrated by Ali radiallahu anhu, Imam Qurtubi rahimahullah have narrated this hadith in his tafsir, مَنِ اسْتَذَلَّ مُؤْمِنًا أَوْ مُؤْمِنَةً أَوْ حَقَرَهُ لِفَقْرِهِ وَقِلَّةِ ذَاتِ يَدِهِ شَهَرَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ ثم فضحة. A person who would look down upon a believer, or a person who would try to insult a believer, be it a man or woman, mu'minan aw mu'mina. You see a group of women sitting, they are dressed, they are well dressed, they are wealthy, they have, Allah has given them a lot of ni'mas. They look down at others, they look at others who don't have the type of dress that they're wearing and then make fun of them. And especially if in that gathering you see a woman with hijab, that's it. She will be the target. And if we really want to make fun of anyone in that gathering, it has to be that mu'mina who is covering herself properly according to the orders of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a person who would humiliate a mu'min or who would look down upon a believer because of that person's poverty, not having what we have, شَهَرَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ ثُمَّ فَضَحَ. Allah will call this person on the day of Qiyamah in the presence of all mankind and will humiliate that person in the presence of all people, will remind him of all of his faults or remind her of all of her faults, of every wrongdoing that this person have done in this world, and they were secret, they were hidden from people. Allah will announce her faults and his faults in public. Then the hadith says, وَمَنْ بَهَتَ مُؤْمِنًا أَوْ مُؤْمِنًا أَوْ قَالَ فِيهِ مَا لَيْسَ فِيهِ أَقَامَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَىٰ تِلِّمْ مِنْ نَارٍ. A person who would accuse, falsely accuse a believer of something that that person have not done, or will say about a believer something that that person have never done, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call that person on the day of Qiyamah. And أَقَامَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ تِلِّمْ مِنْ نَارٍ. Allah will make this person stand on a hill of Jahannam, of a fire, and then will keep him in that position and tell that person, the only thing that will get you out of this place is that you find a way out of what you have said. Which means, tell us the reason why did you say it, and what was the proof for what you have said. Prove what you have said, and then you will be able to come out of the situation. Otherwise you stay there until everyone finishes with his hisab. 100,000 years of hisab, the person will be standing there. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the honor and respect of a believer, akramu alayhi min malakin muqarrab, is more important to Allah than respecting even the closest angel to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَيْسَ شَيْءٌ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ مُؤْمِنٍ تَائِبٍ. Subhanallah, what a beautiful portion of the hadith. Nothing dearer to Allah than a mu'min who have repented to Allah from his faults and his sins. Why did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mention this here in this hadith? Is to remind us that even if you know the wrongdoings of a person, one is falsely accusing the person, but you know the wrongdoings of a person, maybe he have repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his wrongdoing. And now if you accuse that person for his wrongdoings, things that he have repented from, he's loved by Allah. And when you make fun of the person who's loved by Allah, then who is going to be helping this person? Allah will be helping this person against him. And how would that help come? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make sure this person will fall into something like this before he would die. So making fun of others is not a simple thing that we just make, I made fun of him and then I forgot. That person's feelings were hurt. And that pain that he had in his heart because of us making fun of him will someday make us pay for what we have done. Will show the result of our actions someday in our life. We may not remember. 20 years later, we will not remember where is it coming from. Why I'm suffering. Why I'm having hardship. Why everyone makes fun of me. Why no one likes me. Why my boss is always talking against me. Why people around me, they don't want to associate with me. We may not remember after 20, 30 years. It's a result of something that we may have done 20, 30 years back. Insulted someone, made fun of someone, we mocked someone. This is the result of that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُبَدِّلْ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ زُيِّنَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. The worldly life has been beautified for the disbelievers. وَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And a result of running after the beauty of the dunya is making fun of the people of Iman. And this is also very common. Making fun of the people of Iman. In a gathering, someone got up and started calling Adhan. Everyone will make fun of that person. What does he think? Does he think that this is masjid? This mullah thinks that he came to masjid, he came to a wedding. And in wedding he wants to call adhan. And you see him with the person, few people going in the corner and performing salah. And people are staring at them. Mu'mins, believers, who are at least claiming to be. They are looking at those people and making fun of them. They look at them. They think that they are in a masjid here. وَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. They mock the people of iman. They make fun of the people of iman. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The people of taqwa will be above them on the day of qiyamah. وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah provides provision to whoever He wants بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, without any measure, without counting. He keeps on giving. What is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this portion of the ayah? What's the connection of وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ with what we had been seeing in the previous portion of the ayah? Let's look at what Allah told us up to this point in the ayah. The first ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling, reminding us that, see, we gave Bani Israel a lot of ni'mas. They did not appreciate the ni'mah that we gave them. Ask them how many ni'mas we gave them, but they never appreciated. And they changed the ni'mas of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever will do that, even if you people would do that, I will punish you, and my punishment is very severe for those people who would not appreciate my ni'mah. And the reason for not appreciating the ni'mah is people are always looking for the beauty of this dunya, and they like to increase the beauty, get more and more of this dunya. And then gradually, because of this lifestyle, they don't like the lifestyle of iman, of the people of iman. They don't like the simple lifestyle. They don't like those who are in the ibadah of Allah, those who are following the sunnah of Rasulullah. They don't like them anymore. So they make fun of those people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do you think that I can give you the wealth and I cannot give it to them? وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah provides whoever He wants without any measure. I will not count when I give it to them. Don't worry, a day would come when I will give it to them. They will get what they want. Maybe they will get it in this dunya also. And really the rizq is something. Two things that we have to remember about rizq. One is, whatever we get, we are not getting it because of our abilities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives whoever He wants. You see some people who are not as educated as others who are making a lot. But this person may be a millionaire. He may be a millionaire. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the doors of rizq for him. Not because he had the degrees, he had the ability. He started a small store. And then from there Allah gave him the blessing and the ni'mah and the barakah and kept on increasing and increasing. He had a lot of stores now. He may be the owner of hundreds of stores. So Allahu yarzuqu man yashaa bi ghayri hisab. This is one thing. And in that case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not give only to a person who is doing good deeds, which means if a person is being good, Allah will give him more of the dunya and will give him another store and third store and fourth store just because he is being nice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives whoever He wants. In fact, in most of the cases, as we inshallah will talk about it, that the person who is in kufr will get it more than a person who is a mu'min. The reason we'll talk about it in a minute. The second point I want to mention about rizq is, when we survive in this dunya, we really don't survive based on how much we make. We survive through the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People who are making millions of dollars, they survive in the same way as those who are making a couple of hundred dollars. In fact, sometimes the person who's making a few hundred dollars a month, or maybe $1,000 or a couple of $1,000 a month, may be living a better life, happier life than the person who's making millions. And this, in most of the cases, is a fact. We survive through the barakah and the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't survive through the rizq, through what Allah has given us. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He controls the doors of rizq, He controls the doors of needs also. So a person may be getting $5,000. And I met a person who used to make close to $15,000 a month. And he was complaining to me that I'm having a real difficulty in these days. So I said to him, you're making $15,000 a month. And you are complaining about a difficulty in your life? He said, yeah, because we spend close to $13,000-$14,000 a month. Subhanallah, in a family of five people, you spend $13,000-$14,000 a month. You own your own house, you have your businesses, everything, and you're complaining even after making $15,000 a month. There are people who don't even make $15,000 a year with larger family than yours. And they're living very peacefully. So the doors of the needs are also in Allah's hands. If Allah will open the door of need, then you could be making the whole world in a day. And still you would end up spending it and not being satisfied of what you're getting out of what you're spending. And this is what happens most of the time. We spend. At the end of the day, we are not satisfied of where I spend my money. It just went this. It just went there. I don't know what happened to it. I earned so much. I had so much. But I don't have anything anymore. وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah provides. And Allah is the provider. Imam Bukhari rahimahullah have narrated in Sahih on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hadith Qudsi from Sahih al-Bukhari, قال الله عز وجل يبن آدم أنفق أنفق عليك. O human being, you keep on spending, I will spend on you. You keep on spending on others, I will keep on spending on you. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in, يد الله ملأ لا تغيضها نفخة سحاء الليل والنهار. Allah's hands are full. Spending never reduces of what he has. And he keeps on spending day and night. يد الله ملأ, Allah's hands are full. لا تغيضها نفقة. Spending never reduces anything from what he has. And he keeps on spending day and night. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا أَنْفَقَ مُنْذُ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يُغْضِ مَا فِي يَدِهِ. See what Allah has spent from the time he created the heaven and the earth. Whatever he is spending on all of his creature, that did not reduce a bit from what Allah owns. So if Allah will give us 1 million or 2 million, is he going to lose something? وَالْعَيَازُ بِاللَّهِ. He's not going to lose anything. Everything is in his control. But the thing is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya wants to test us. He made this dunya to test people. Now we may say that if Allah has the full control and is my Rabb and I worship Allah, then Allah should be giving me more. He should be giving me more than he gives to a disbeliever, to a person who's disobeying him. No. This is not how it works. Let me ask you this, so that we can understand this point very easily. What are some of the highest paying jobs in the world, or in our country? What is the highest paying job, where you get the highest salary, make the highest amount of money? Maybe becoming a lawyer, or a doctor, or an architect. These may be some of the highest ones, maybe some others. My question is, how come everyone in the country does not become a doctor? Everyone in the country does not become a lawyer. Everyone in the country does not become an architect. What's the reason behind it? You tell a person who's about to select a major for himself, you tell him, you know, the highest paying salary is to choose one of these. Why don't you become one of these? No, I can't do this. But why? No, it's too difficult for me. See, there are difficulties on the way of getting the higher salary. And then, say a person comes and he says, today I graduated as a doctor. What do you think it's in his mind that he will have to do next? Is it an easy life now he's going to live after this? In fact, in his mind, at this time he will be living the most difficult life for some years because he has to do residency. And that may be the most difficult time of his life. And therefore, at that time, with a lot of difficulty, he's forcing himself just to continue with it. He does not want to be in that position. But since I studied all of this, let me just force myself and finish these 2 years. Then someone says to him, why don't you do this specialty? Become this, choose some specialty for yourself. He says, no, that's it for me. If you do this, right now you will be making $200,000 a month. If you do this, you will make $500,000 a month. He says, I don't want $500,000. You keep it. This is to tell us that when a person is going towards making more, making a better living, better life, will always be more difficulties on his way. This is why I really feel bad for people who are wealthy when they come and give us some gift or something. I feel bad for them that the poor guy really worked very hard. He did not work hard for me. He worked hard for himself. He should keep it for himself. I did not work hard for those things, so I don't really want them. Let him have it. Let him enjoy it because he worked very hard for it. So for getting there, you have to work hard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have prepared a really high and a great reward for us in Akhirah. In order for us to obtain that, we need to work for some time. This is our time when we are on duty. Just in this life. We are working in this life. For those people who will not work in this life, they would be having a hard time over there once they go to the next world. For the people of Iman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, just work for some time over here. And then you would enjoy the hard work that you have put for my pleasure. You will enjoy that time. You will enjoy that work. So, for the people of Iman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put this life for work. So keep on working. Don't look at what people have. You just keep on working. And then a time would come when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you for all of what you have done. You will get paid for whatever you have done, and you will get much more than what you have worked for. There will be more reward, more gifts than your real earning. Just work a little hard in this life. That's all about it. But because people see the difficulties when it comes to Iman and practicing Deen, when people see the difficulties, sometimes they choose to go the other direction. They don't realize that this difficult work, because of the high payment, the high salary that you get for this work. So right now, the harder you work for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the higher salary will be there for you. The higher, more gifts you will get, the better place you would get by Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah provides whoever He wants without any hisab. When He gives, He does not count. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Asma radiyallahu anha, the daughter of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, Ya Asma, anfiqi, keep on spending, wardiqi, and keep on giving and giving and giving. Because, وَلَا تُحْصِي فَيُحْصِي اللَّهُ عَلَيْكِ وَلَا تُوكِي فَيُوكِي اللَّهُ عَلَيْكِ. Don't count when you give, because Allah will count then when He's giving you. And don't try to reserve what you have, because Allah then will hold it back from you too, just like you hold it back from others. As much as you keep on giving, Allah will keep on giving it to you. Imam Zainul Abideen rahimahullah, he used to spend a lot. So someone said to him that, you know, you should look at your needs also. You have a large family. You should save something for yourself. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who have spoiled me. So the person looked at him, what do you mean Allah spoiled you? He said, Allah made me used to this, that He gives me and I spend. When I spend, He gives me even more. And every time I spend, I get even more than what I have spent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who spoiled me. Now, if I stop giving, He will stop giving me too. So I'm getting because I'm spending. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving me also more because of the spending. So, وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. It's really a fact. It's a fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He gives, He does not count. He just keeps on giving. But as long as we have to make sure that it comes as a ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we appreciate the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. مولاي صل وسلم دائما.